Okay, so let's start our today's topic. So we are discussing immunity. We discussed that immunity is provided by two responses. One is known as innate or non-specific immunity or immune response, and another is known as adaptive or specific immune response, right? So first time we are discussing this innate or non-specific immunity. We discussed that innate or non-specific immunity, it is provided first by skin. Then we discussed mucosa. Then we discussed phagocytes, right? So skin, mucosa and phagocytes, they also provide, they are the components of innate or non-specific immunity. Similarly, we are today going to discuss about inflammatory response. This inflammatory response, it is again a component of non-specific or innate immunity. So what is inflammatory response? So whenever any foreign particle, whenever any pathogen, or whenever our body gets injured, after infection or after injury, our body develops a swelling. This swelling of body tissue in response to an infection or in response to an injury, that is known as inflammation. And this response of our immune system, this inflammation is produced by our immune system. This response of our immune system to generate inflammation, to produce inflammation, this is known as inflammatory response. So whenever we get an infection or whenever our body gets injured, at the site of infection or at the site of injury, we develop a swelling. This swelling is known as inflammation. This swelling is caused by the action of our immune system. So our immune system reacts against the injury or against the infection. This reaction of immune system against the infection or against the injury, this is known as inflammatory response. So what happens in this inflammatory response? In this inflammatory response, we develop PRISH. PRISH is an acronym. P stands for pain. So at the site of inflammation, we develop pain, right? We develop pain. R stands for redness. At the site of inflammation, we develop redness. I stands for immobility. The tissue which undergoes swelling doesn't allow movements. Suppose our elbow gets injured, it develops a swelling. After swelling, we are not able to make the movement of the elbow joint. So that is known as immobility. Then there is S. S stands for swelling. So swelling occurs at the site of injury or at the site of infection. Then H, H stands for heat. So our inflammatory response, it is characterized by these five things. And inflammatory response is characterized by these five things. So in inflammation, there is pain. The site of body where inflammation occurs. The site of body where we have infection or the site of body where we have got injured, right? That site of body develops pain. That side of the body becomes red. That side of body becomes immobile. That doesn't allow the movements. That restricts the movements. At that site, we develop swelling. At the site of injury or at the site of infection, we develop swelling. And the tissue becomes hot. It is characterized by generation of heat, right? When someone slaps you on the face, you might have experienced hot flashes after the slap. So that is heat. Right? So whenever our body tissues get injured or get infected, at the site of infection or at the site of injury, we develop these symptoms. We develop pain, we develop redness, we develop immobility, we develop swelling and heat. Right? So this all reaction of the immune system, it is all caused by immune response. So this immune response is known as inflammatory response. And it is characterized by PRISH. PRISH stands for pain, redness, immobility, swelling, and heat. This is the acronym PRISH. Or we also call it as, we also say inflammatory response is characterized by calor. Calor means heat. Dolor. Dolor means pain. Rubor. Rubor means redness. Tumor. Tumor means swelling. And functio lisa. And functio lisa. It means least function. Least function. Or we call it as immobility. So our inflammatory response is characterized by calor, heat is generated, dolor, pain is generated. That is why when you are suffering from pain, you take dolo, 650 or 620, something like that. Rubor, rubor means redness. Tumor, tumor means swelling. And functio lisa means least function, right? So these are the characteristic features of inflammatory response. So when an inflammatory response is generated, so when our body tissues get infected, or when our body tissues get injured, an inflammatory response is developed by our immune system. And that inflammatory response is characterized by these things, pain, redness, immobility, swelling, and heat, right? Or we say calor, heat, dolor, pain, rubor, redness, tumor, swelling, and functio lisa, least function or immobility. Is this inflammatory response a defensive response or it is a harmful response? Actually, inflammatory response is a defensive response, right? So when injury occurs, our immune system makes that part immobile so that further movements do not further cause damage to the body tissue. That is why immobility is developed. Pain develops because of injury to the body tissue. Redness develops because of the local dilation of blood vessels. Swelling develops because of the accumulation of fluid. Heat develops so that heat is developed by pyrogens, so that immune system is stimulated for further action, right? These are the characteristic features of inflammatory response. So how this inflammatory response is generated? How this inflammatory response is generated? So we will discuss that. Inflammatory response is developed on infection or injury. So body tissues or inflammatory response may be developed when allergy occurs. When allergy occurs. So inflammation is produced on infection or on injury to body tissue. Or inflammation may be also produced because of some allergy. So these are two different mechanisms. Infection or injury and allergy, they are two different. They involve two different mechanisms. So first we will see how inflammation is produced when our body gets infected or when we receive an injury. So first we will discuss that. So whenever our body gets injured, when our body gets injured, or it is infected, or our body tissues are infected, at that time, microbe-associated molecular patterns, or we also call them as pathogen-associated molecular patterns, microbe-associated molecular patterns, or we also call them as pathogen associated pathogen associated molecular pattern. Or sometimes there are damage associated molecular pattern, DAM. Damage associated molecular pattern. So when our body gets injured or infected, our body recognizes some small protein molecules. These small protein molecules, they are known as, they may be protein molecules or they may be glycoproteins or they may be glycolipids. They may be glycoproteins or they may be glycolipids. These pathogen associated molecular patterns or damage associated molecular patterns, they are actually glycolipids or glycoproteins. So where from these come? These glycoproteins and glycolipids, they are present on the surface of, cell surface of microbes, or they are present on the cell surface of pathogens. So when a pathogen or microbe enters into our body, it is eaten up by phagocytic cells. Those phagocytic cells, they digest the pathogen, leaving its cell surface antigens, which we call as microbe-associated molecular patterns or pathogen-associated molecular patterns. These are actually cell surface antigens, leaving them intact. And then they present, these glycoproteins or glycolipids, which are present, which were present on the cell surface of the pathogen. Suppose this is a bacterium. This is a bacterium. On its body surface, there are glycoproteins or glycolipids. These glycoproteins or glycolipids, they are known as cell surface antigens, or we call them as microbe-associated molecular pattern or pathogen-associated molecular pattern, right? So these are the PAMP. These are the PAMP. So they are PAMP, pathogen-associated molecular pattern. What are they actually? They are actually glycoproteins or glycolipids, which are present on the plasma membrane of all the living cells, right? So when this bacterium enters into our body, this bacterium is eaten up by a phagocytic cell. This bacterium is eaten up by a phagocytic cell. This phagocytic cell, it digests the bacteria. It digests the bacteria. It kills the bacteria, leaving its cell surface antigens intact. They are not digested or they are partially digested. Leaving its cell surface antigens intact, either they are not digested or they are partially digested. Then this phagocytic cell, then it displays these antigens of the pathogen on its own surface. So these are the antigens of the pathogen, which are now displayed by the phagocytic cell. Phagocytic cell, or we call it as antigen presenting cell, on its own surface, right? So when a pathogen enters into our body, this is the bacterium. It entered into our body. This bacterium was eaten up by phagocytic cell. It was eaten up by a phagocytic cell. This is a phagocytic cell. Right? It was eaten up by a phagocytic cell. Phagocytic cell digests the bacteria, but it does not digest its cell surface antigens, which are known as pathogen-associated molecular patterns. Right? They are not digested. They are partially digested or not digested. So these partially digested or undigested cell surface antigens of the bacteria, now this phagocytic cell displays them on its own surface. This phagocytic cell displays these pathogen associated molecular patterns on its own surface. Now this phagocytic cell displays these pathogen associated molecular patterns on its own surface, and it presents them to mast cells. Mast cells are the cells which are present in our connective tissue. They are present in the connective tissue of tissues of our various body organs. So these phagocytic cells, we also call them as antigen presenting cells. They present the antigens of bacteria to mast cells, and these mast cells, they get stimulated. Mast cells get stimulated, and on recognizing these pathogen associated molecular pattern, mast cells, they get stimulated. This is a mast cell. When it is given pathogen associated molecular patterns, this phagocytic cell, it presented it the pathogen associated molecular patterns on cell surface antigens of bacteria. This cell gets stimulated, and it secretes a substance by degranulation. It has got some granules in it. It degranulates. It releases some substance from its granules. These substances are released. It releases histamine. It releases heparin. It releases prostaglandins. It releases leukotrienes. So mast cells, they release some substances. Mast cells release some substances when they are stimulated by the pathogen associated molecular pattern. So it releases histamine, it releases heparin, it releases prostaglandins, it releases leukotrienes. All these substances, they get involved. They are involved in production of inflammation. These substances cause the inflammation. I will again repeat it. So when our body gets injured or infected, first we are discussing the case of injury. Yeah, first we are discussing the case of infection. So when our body gets infected, infection is caused by pathogens. All those pathogens are having some specific antigens on their surface. Those antigens are actually glycoproteins or glycolipids. We have discussed the structure of plasma membrane. When we discussed the structure of plasma membrane, we found that there were oligosaccharide chains attached to proteins. Those oligosaccharide chains which are attached to proteins, they in combination with proteins were known as glycoproteins. Then some oligosaccharide chains were attached to lipids. So those lipids which had oligosaccharide chains attached to them, they were known as glycolipids. I told you at that time, these glycoproteins and glycolipids, they serve as cell surface identicards. They serve as identicards of the cell. This pattern of glycoproteins and glycolipids, it is unique to every organism. They do not match. They are genetically controlled. They do not match, right? So these glycoproteins and glycolipids, which are present on the plasma membrane of cells, they are known as cell surface antigens, or we call them as identicards of the cell, by which cells recognize each other as self or non-self. So they are present on each and every cell. So we take example of bacteria. So this bacteria also has got its glycoproteins and glycolipids on its surface. So it is glycoproteins and glycolipids which are present on its surface. They are known as the antigens, or we call them as PAMP, pathogen associated molecular patterns. So these glycoproteins and glycolipids, they are having a specific molecular pattern. They have got a specific arrangement of sugars and proteins. So they are molecular patterns, right? So we call those cell surface antigens as pathogen associated molecular patterns, right? Or sometimes we use a broader term known as microbe associated molecular pattern. So they may be present in any type of cell, even on the viruses, they are present, right? So that is why we call them also as microbe associated molecular pattern. So these pathogen-associated molecular patterns or microbe-associated molecular patterns, they are actually the glycoproteins or the glycolipids, which are present on the cell surface of pathogens, So suppose this is a bacterium. It has got pathogen-associated molecular patterns on its surface. Now, as the bacterium enters into the body cell, body tissues, this bacterium is killed by, it is eaten by phagocytic cell. This phagocytic cell, which has eaten this bacterium, digests the bacterium, but it does not digest these pathogen-associated molecular patterns or cell surface antigens of the bacterium. So these cell surface antigens of the bacterium, they are either not digested or they are partially digested. So after partial digestion, or if they are not digested, then this phagocytic cell, it displays these antigens of the bacterium on its own surface. And then this phagocytic cell, it goes and contacts the mast cell, and it hands over these antigens of the bacterium to mast cell. Now this phagocytic cell, it will go to the mast cell, and it will hand over these pathogen-associated molecular patterns, or we call them as microbe-associated molecular patterns. It will hand over them to mast cell. As mast cell recognizes these pathogen-associated molecular patterns or microbe-associated molecular patterns, this mast cell gets stimulated. And it degranulates. It releases some chemicals. This mast cell, when it comes in contact with the cell surface antigens of the pathogen, it releases some chemicals. Which chemicals are released by mast cell? It releases histamine, it releases heparin, it releases prostaglandins, and it releases leukotrienes. It is the release of these chemicals from the mast cell which cause the inflammation. So among them, the most prominent inflammation-producing substance is histamine. So when mast cell releases histamine, this histamine stimulates the development of inflammation. How does this histamine stimulate the development of inflammation? When the histamine is released in body tissue, this histamine, it causes local dilation of blood vessels. So we will first see the effects of histamine. Histamine causes local dilation of blood vessels. So when blood vessels become dilated, blood flow to that area in which dilation of blood vessels occurred. So when in any body tissue, dilation of blood vessels causes supply of more blood to that area. And that area becomes red. Why the area becomes red? Because blood vessels dilate and more blood flows into that area. So increased flow of blood into that area causes the redness. Then histamine increases permeability of post capillary venules. When capillaries join, they form venules. Then venules join, they form veins. Due to release of histamine, the post-capillary venules, they become more permeable. So when they become permeable, they leak out plasma. Plasma leaks out in body tissue. So from blood, plasma now escapes plasma escapes from the blood vessels and it accumulates in body tissues. Accumulation of plasma in body tissue causes the swelling. Whenever any fluid accumulates in body tissues, that causes the swelling of that body area, right? So when histamine is released, histamine increases permeability of post-capillary venules. So when post-capillary venules become more permeable, plasma leaks out in tissues, plasma leaks out in body tissues, and this accumulation of plasma in body tissues, it causes swelling, right? Then histamine and histamine causes chemotaxis. It generates chemotaxis. Chemotaxis means chemical attraction. Histamine attracts phagocytic sites, phagocytic cells to the site of infection, So phagocytic cells, they are attracted by the chemical attraction of histamine to this site where the plasma has leaked out. So these phagocytic cells, they look for pathogens. And kill them. So when phagocytic cells reach to the site of inflammation, they look for the pathogens and they kill them. And this leaked out plasma, it dilutes the toxins of pathogen. So plasma is released out from the post-capillary venules in the tissue so that if there are any toxins released by the pathogen, those toxins will be neutralized. Those toxins will be diluted, right? So this is the action of histamine. So this swelling, it is all caused due to release of histamine. So how histamine causes the swelling? So when histamine is released from the mast cells, histamine causes local dilation of the blood vessels, increasing blood flow to the site of injury or site of infection. Due to increased blood flow, the area becomes red. Then histamine increases the permeability of capillary venules, post-capillary venules. So when post-capillary venules become more permeable, plasma leaks out in the surrounding body tissue. As plasma builds up in surrounding body tissue, it causes swelling. So another feature of inflammation, swelling. So this swelling is caused by release of plasma from the post-capillary venules. This plasma tries to dilute any toxins released by the pathogen. When the pathogen enters into body tissues, the pathogen may release toxins and this plasma dilutes those toxins so that damage is not caused to the body tissue. Then histamine generates chemotaxis. Histamine causes chemical attraction of phagocytic cells. All the phagocytic cells of the body, they rush towards the site of injury or the site of infection. And they look for the pathogens to kill them, right? So in this way, an inflammation is produced. So this inflammation, as we can now understand, it is a defensive response. And inflammation is a defensive response. So that the body tissues are protected from the action of those pathogens or the toxins of those pathogens. And in this inflammation, histamine plays an important role. Heparin is also released. You know, heparin is an anticoagulant. This anticoagulant is released so that blood continues to flow in greater amounts to the site of infection. Heparin is released so that it acts as an anticoagulant. It doesn't allow the coagulation of blood in the injured tissue or in the infected tissue, so that blood keeps running towards this infected area, right? Similarly, prostaglandins are released. Prostaglandins also cause inflammation. And leukotrienes are involved, released. Those leukotrienes, they stimulate other leukocytes to come to the site of infection and kill the pathogen. Leukotrienes are released. They stimulate other leukocytes to come to the site of infection and destroy the pathogen. This is the underlying mechanism of an inflammatory response. So how this inflammatory response is developed, we discussed that. So this inflammatory response is developed when the site gets infected or when any body tissue gets injured. We will discuss mechanism of inflammation in injury, inshallah, tomorrow. We are running now out of the time. So this is section for today. In the next lecture, we will discuss how inflammation is produced in response to an injury. Thank you for being with me.